Hello, church family. If you are out there, we just want to do a quick check. We're trying to use a little bit of a mic system today. So if someone could throw in the comment section just to make sure that you could hear the piano. Can you hear me? Just want to make sure that we are live. Anybody? Comment. Hello? Can you hear me? Try this here. All right. I'm getting some thumbs up. We're looking good. So, well, this is not our traditional way to gather. So Daniel and I get extra points here for being here today, but we are still 6 feet apart. I don't know. We're a ways apart. But anyway, it's awesome to see you guys out there, and I'm grateful that we have this medium to be together today. One of the things that we want to do as we get started today is Daniel's actually going to share with you, I can't remember off the top of my head, what songs that we're going to be singing together. That way, if you have another device or if you can kind of pull those up, so you can kind of have those ready and not be shuffling through. So, Daniel?
All right. Hopefully you guys can hear me okay. We're going to start off with Whom Shall I Fear?
Chris Tomlin.
Yeah. And then we're going to sing The Old Rugged Cross. And then as far as the first songs in the set, we'll sing Trust and Obey. Okay. So those are the three to remember for now.
All right. And then we'll be doing a few more later. But Let's open in prayer. Thank you guys for being here tonight. Lord Jesus, this is a very unconventional way. This is a unique moment in history, but we know that you're here and we are here. And so we thank you for the privilege of coming to the cross of Christ this Good Friday night. And Lord, I just ask that your presence would be in our homes, that it would be among our family. Lord, that you would visit us this night as we rest in you and as we trust in you, as we celebrate and remember the day, Lord, when you gave everything for us. And Lord, I just ask, Lord, that we would just be fixing our eyes on you in these moments ahead, and that absolutely nothing would be lost in the Spirit. Lord, we cannot wait to come back together, but nothing would be lost as we pour our hearts out to you in remembrance for what you have done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Your strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me, yours is a victory. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I've changed old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still. And with all who will trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows, for the joy He bestows, and for them who will trust and obey. Oh, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And in fellowship sweet, we shall sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Thank you, Daniel. Appreciate that. One of the things that I forgot to mention at the beginning, we will be taking communion a little bit later on. I really actually enjoyed hearing how all of you guys took communion at your houses the other day. I heard everything from goldfish to Ritz to coffee with cream. The elements are insignificant. And so at some point, you can probably stick around. We'll do a song together after this, and then we'll have communion. But have someone slip out and maybe grab a piece of bread or a juice cup or, you know, something to be able to participate with us. So that is coming. I'm sorry for not mentioning that earlier, but we will get to that. So as we get going today, of course, I left my Bible all the way over there. You want to hand that to me? Ooh. Oh, there it is. All right. Hey, thanks. Did you sanitize this?
Nope.
Okay. But as we get going today, I want to read a section of scripture for you and just let that section just sit. It's the, this is in John chapter 19, and we are going to read starting on verse 16. together. So he, being Pilate, then handed Jesus over to be crucified. They took Jesus, therefore, and he went out, bearing his own cross to the place called the Skull, which was in Hebrew is called Golgotha. And there they crucified him, and with two other men, one on either side, and Jesus between. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It was written, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Therefore, many Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Latin and Greek. And so the chief priests of the Jews were saying to Pilate, do not write that he is the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews. And Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. And the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, they took his outer garments and they made it four parts, a part for every soldier, and also the tunic. But now the tunic was seamless. It was woven in one piece. And they said to one another, let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to decide whose it shall be. And this was to fulfill the scripture, that they divided my outer garments among them. For my clothing they cast lots. And therefore the soldiers did these things. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother, his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. From that hour, this disciple took her into his own home. And after this, Jesus, knowing that all things had already been accomplished to fulfill the scripture, he said, I am thirsty. And a jar full of sour wine was standing there. And so they put the sponge up full of sour wine upon the branch of hyssop, and they brought it to his mouth. Therefore, when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. Where I want us to sit tonight is at the foot of the cross, as we sit in the same place that Mary and Mary and Mary and the sister of Mary and John, and I'm sure a few others were sitting that night. What must it have been like to sit at the foot of the crucified Christ? I mean, just a moment, days before, right? Jesus, he's a 30-some-odd-year-old man. He's healthy, he's strong, he's free, he's loving people, he's healing people, he's performing miracles, he's doing life, and it seems like in a matter of hours, everything completely changed. The unexpected completely took over life. As so many have pointed out, you know, before me and will continue to point after me, how different was Palm Sunday than Good Friday, right? That in Palm Sunday, they're welcoming their king, they're excited, they're in anticipation, they're expecting the coming of power, and they have great hope. And then just within a few days, right, by Good Friday, by Thursday, Friday, by Friday, they're witnessing the execution of the man that they proclaimed as king. Right? What happened to their future, this future glory? What happened to their hope? What happened to all their plans of everything that was going to take place? And here they are at the foot of the cross, completely shaken with everything that they had rested their life and their hope in, now being nailed to a cross. And one of the things I want us to catch this year is that this is perhaps the most unique Good Friday of Christian history, aside from the first one. And it's not just because everybody's doing it online, right? But this is so unique because I think for the first time in 2,000 years, the world experiences Good Friday the way that the disciples and those that were close to Jesus experienced Good Friday. You know, when we experience the Holy Week, you know, we have a great advantage. We know how it ends, right? We always say, right, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And Holy Week for us is, it's like watching a sports rerun, which I hear are all over ESPN right now. And they're fun to watch, right? But you know how it ends. It's already been written, and so the middle doesn't really matter because you know what's going to ultimately take place, right? And that's Holy Week for us, right? It's already been written, but that wasn't what Holy Week was for the disciples. That wasn't what this Passover was. It wasn't a rerun. It wasn't live. It wasn't pre-recorded. It was live. And so where we say it's Friday, but Sunday's coming, the disciples were saying it's Friday. What will become of Sunday? What does Sunday look like? And to really realize for the disciples, for those that had left everything, what was at stake for them in losing Christ in their very eyes, right? I mean, these people had given their lives to follow Jesus. They had left businesses, they had left family members, relatives, the aspirations of things and plans that they had in their life that were not coming to fulfillment because they had left it. Peter says to Jesus in Mark chapter 10, we've left everything to follow after you. And now everything that they have leaned themselves on in life is nailed to a cross and is dying in front of their very eyes. I remember the first time I went to a real concert. I went to a Third Day concert. I don't know if you know who that is. It's a Christian band. They've been around for a long time. I don't even know if they're still recording. But I went to and so we were down in Salem. We're at this Third Day concert, and they brought out this band. I'm like, who's these guys? And then they brought out another band. I'm like, who are they? Like, when is Third Day going to? I thought I came to a Third Day concert. Well, they're called opening acts. I had no idea. I was young. I didn't know they did that kind of thing, right? And the opening acts, if their name would have been on the ticket, I would have never bought the ticket. Like, I didn't come to see them. They're making their little living. They're getting their little taste of glory or fame because they're attached to Third Day. This was the apostles, the disciples' lot in life. Like, they weren't going to go out. No one was lining up to see the disciples. They were lining up to see Jesus. The reason that they had a following was because they were connected to Christ. What happens when Christ leaves? They're an opening band. They're gone. Their livelihood, the way that they have ministered and moved and what they've given their lives to, it all falls apart because Jesus is the centerpiece of it. And so, yeah, it's Friday, but what is going to become of Sunday? What is going to become of Sunday? And I think it's just so humbling to come to Good Friday today as a world. I mean, not just as a person with knowing what, you know, having insecurity or uncertainty in your life, or even as a church or as a business or as a community or even a nation. As a world, we're coming to the foot of the cross. And what we have leaned ourselves on is being shaken before our very eyes. And everybody's asking the question. Some are asking out of fear. Some are asking out of speculation. Some are asking in order to position themselves for power or for success. But they're asking the question, what does Sunday look like? What does Sunday look like? And we've had thousands of dollars invested in these models, right, to try to find out, what does Sunday look like? They're not doing very good, by the way. But what does Sunday look like? Everybody wants to know. If this thing runs its course, right, what is on the other side of this? It's Friday. But what about Sunday? You see, we've always come to the cross with expectation. We've always come to the cross knowing the history that's been written. And we come on Friday, or we come on a Monday, Thursday service, and then Friday happens, and then Saturday we know that we have the day off, and Sunday we're going to wake up, and we're going to put on our Easter best, and we're going to come to church, and the brass is going to play, and the choir is going to sing, and we're going to have this big celebration, and we're going to go home, and we're going to have a dinner, and the kids are going to hunt eggs, and it's just going to be this one big thing. But for the people that were there on Good Friday, this was not their experience. They were there in despair, in grief, in uncertainty, and fear. And one of the things that I'm realizing as I walk through this and I'm thinking about what Good Friday was for them, that for those that were there before the cross of Christ ever established them, it wrecked them. It wrecked them. It just broke them. Because at the cross of Christ, they didn't just lose Jesus. They lost their own lives, everything that they had put themselves into, right? What they had trusted their future to, everything was being questioned. It was being threatened. It was being shaken. Would it be here Sunday? Would it be here Sunday? And this is the culmination of all of it here that I just want you to hear this, all right? For these people that were at the foot of the cross of Christ, what it means to be at the place at the foot of the cross of Christ is that all of our hope is in God. That the foot of the cross is that place in which your only hope is God. And church, this is what it means for us to come to the foot of the cross of Christ, is this place in which all earthly hope, all earthly, I'm not sounding, don't hear me being Debbie Downer or anything like that, okay? But I'm just saying, when we come to the cross of Christ, we come to the place in which all of our hope is in God, because earthly hope, it's not going to save it. It's not going to save Jesus in this situation, right? And it's the place that we come where we recognize that all of our hope is in Christ. And I was thinking about these models. I know they've come under scrutiny about the coronavirus models that have come under scrutiny lately. And Dr. Fauci was talking. He said, well, the models are only as good as the data that you put into them. I agree. But here's why they're having so much trouble predicting it from day one now, is how do you quantify the grace of God in a model? You can't account for it. And so we're in this place, we're in this Friday where how do you account for the immeasurable grace of the Lord Jesus Christ? You can't do it. And so here we are, it's Friday, church. And what will become of Sunday? We are with the disciples in the place in which God is our hope. But we never, ever, ever underestimate the limitless grace and saving power of God. I know for some of us, it shakes us to even think, are we really in a place in which our only hope is God? Like, we want to be in a place where we have hope for God, hope in God, and hope in ourselves. Are we really in a place where our only hope is God? I'm not going to answer that question, but I will say this. Isn't that the most secure hope we can have? Isn't that really what we believe? Isn't that the greatest place to get hope? To continue out the parallel as I bring it to a close here. After the crucifixion, the disciples, they quarantined. And they locked themselves up in their homes or in a room for fear that what happened to Jesus might happen to them or might happen to someone that they loved. And when they had their first Holy Week, they had to wait. They had no crystal ball. Nothing was there to, other than the word of Christ, nothing was there to tell them what Sunday would hold, right? But they were going to have to rest their faith. There was no shortcuts. They were going to have to press through that season. There was no shortcuts to get to the day in which God appointed to bring them through on the other side. And so John chapter 16, the word that must have been reverberating throughout their mind, before Jesus goes to the cross, he says to the disciples, truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep, you will lament, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will be turned to joy. Whenever a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when she gives birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy that the child has been born into the world. Therefore, you too, you will grieve now, but I will see you again. And your heart will rejoice, and no one will take that joy from you. And Jesus brought them to the fire. They walked in the fire, but they walked through the fire. And Christ brought them through. And when it felt like tomorrow was slipping away, this new beginning was just arising in the kingdom of God. When God began to do the shaking, God was also doing the establishing. And I want to just leave you with this, that the God of the process is also the God of the outcome. The God of the process is also the God of the outcome. And so as we come to the cross today, Daniel, I'm going to ask you to come and continue. We're going to sing, and then we're going to take communion together. We have no crystal ball for Sunday, and we don't know what day in terms of what we're asking the Lord for now that Sunday's coming. But we trust that the Lord's going to lead us through, and we will cling to his word. We will cling that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is the risen King, and he is our Savior. That is his identity. And so as we walk through this, this is truly our Good Friday, that we look forward to a history that for us is not yet written, but we believe the word of Christ, that though we may weep, though we may lament, though we may be worked up now, Sunday is coming. Sunday's coming, church. So we come to the foot of the cross today to remember in whom our hope and our faith is built. So we'll sing Love Rain Red. Gotcha.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red in my sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you. And here my hope is found, here on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here you save my life. Here I bow down, here I bow. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe to you, I owe to you, Jesus.
Well, I hope you've had a moment to grab some makeshift communion materials. Hopefully you guys aren't eating dinner while we're doing this and you just have it in front of you. Maybe you are. But I'd like with you, if you got your Bibles with you, go ahead and turn over to Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 22. Said verse 14 and following, it says, when the hour had come, he reclined at the table, and the apostles were with him. And he said to them, that I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. Now listen to this part, he says. For I say to you, I shall never eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Now I want you to hear what Jesus is prophesying here, what he is saying about himself. He is not saying this is the last time he's going to eat this meal. He's saying he's not going to eat it until it has been fulfilled. In other words, Jesus is saying there is a new day dawning tomorrow, right? It's Friday. It's Thursday here. Friday, but Sunday is coming. Even when we have not yet written the history, Sunday is coming. Jesus is proclaiming it right here. And so as we take communion together today, we do proclaim Christ's death, but we also proclaim the fullness of the kingdom of God that is continuing on the move and the good things that the Lord has for his people. It is Friday, church, but I want to tell you, Sunday is coming. Sunday is certain, and it is on its way as we walk through. Jesus continues on. It says, when he had given thanks and taken the cup, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now until the kingdom comes. There is more story to be written. This is not the end. This is a whole new beginning. Remember that? How does Scripture write stories? How does the Lord write stories? Not beginning, middle, end. Beginning, middle, new beginning. Beginning, middle, new beginning. Jesus is proclaiming a new beginning for his people and his church. It said, and when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. You take the bread. And in the same way, he took the cup. And after they had eaten, and he said this, this cup is poured out for you. Remember that, church. It's for you. It's for you. As Paul said, will he not freely give us all things? If God gave us his son, will he not freely give us all things? This is poured out for you. Where am I? This cup which is poured out for you in the new covenant of my blood. Let's drink together. Let me say a word of prayer. Daniel's going to do a couple more songs. What are the songs?
The blood will never lose its power and the wonderful cross.
Okay. Thank you. It's Friday. And even though it's not written yet, church, Sunday is coming. Lord Jesus, we thank you that even when you sat down at the Last Supper with your disciples, it's really improperly named. It wasn't the Last Supper. It may have been the Last Supper of the old story. But Lord Jesus, there was another one coming. For you were writing a whole new beginning. And the disciples had to go through a fire. You went through a fire to get there. But what a glorious beginning it was. And so Lord, we just pray as we walk through Good Friday, in much the same way that your disciples did, that this day would be holy to us, and that we would proclaim, that we would not lose faith, that this day would not be a day of despair, this day would not be a day of hopelessness. Lord, even though we have had the privilege of knowing the story of your death and resurrection, Lord, now we're living our own story. And may we also, Lord, stand firm in our faith, knowing that the same God who rose Jesus from the dead lives in us, Lord, and our story is not yet complete. And may we drink it anew as Sunday approaches. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
That Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, he will never lose its power and reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. And the blood that gives me strength from day to day, he will never lose its power. It soothes my doubts hurts and calms my fears. And it dries all my tears, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power, and it reaches to the highest mountain, and it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, he will never lose. He will never lose. He will never lose its power. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss. And poor content on all my pride. Seeing from his hand, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow down. Did there such love and sorrow meet? Oh, thorns compose so rich a crown. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, you gather grace, draw near and bless your name. Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. So amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. Bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace. so amazing, so divine. Demands my soul, my life, my own.
Well, family, we really, really miss you. And it's Friday, but Sunday is coming. And I can't wait for Sunday. Not only this Sunday, I'm really looking forward to this Sunday, but I'm really looking forward to the Sunday of rejoicing when our deliverer proves true. And I'm going to pray with you, and I just want to just encourage you to stay in the season of intercession, to stay in the season of uplifting our leaders, uplifting people that are sick, uplifting our medical personnel, and uplifting our economy and the businesses that are struggling right now. We have a lot of difficult decisions to make in the days ahead that are bigger than us. And we need the Lord's help. We are at the foot of the cross, that the Lord would take us through and that the Lord would grant us peace, especially in our leaders, that the Lord would grant us peace as we walk through this. Jesus is Lord. And there's a lot of facets going in this. It's too complex for me, but it's not too complex for him. And at the moment in which the people at the foot of the cross thought was the darkest, it was actually the moment in which light was beginning to burst forth brighter than it ever has before. We are a people of hope because we are children of God. And our stories are not beginning, middle, end. They're always beginning, middle, new beginning. And we pray that the Lord would enter us into a new beginning. Lord, not only as Lynchwood Church of God, but as the Church of Jesus Christ worldwide in the days to come. Let me pray for you. Lord Jesus, it's Friday, but Sunday is coming. You are our Savior. It is your identity. You are the God of deliverance. You are the God who establishes your kingdom. Lord, in the midst of the darkest night, you are the God of reversals, who takes things that the enemy means for evil, Lord, and you use them for good. And we just submit ourselves to you right now. And we ask, Lord, that we would have faith, that we would have faith that you are in control, that you are Lord, that you are working for our good, that you are working for the good of this world. Lord, not of worldly things, but for the good of this world. And Lord, for the good of your kingdom. And so we can trust you in these days moving forward. We miss one another, Lord Jesus. But we thank you that even when we don't have fellowship with one another, we always have fellowship through and in the Holy Spirit. Now be with us this evening as we reflect at the foot of the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. I do want to give you one more plug as we close here before I send off. A couple days ago, we sent out a couple information things. I don't know if you got it, either email or Facebook, but we're trying to get some videos to put a video together to post on Easter Sunday, the family's checking in. So right now, if you're sitting with your family, grab your smartphone and take a small video, 30 seconds or whatever, say hi, and then at the top where it says send to, go to lynchwoodoffice@gmail.com, lynchwoodoffice@gmail.com, and send it there, because I'm going to put all those together, and so we can post all the families and people of the church saying hello to each other on Sunday morning. But I need to do that tomorrow, so get that done right now. Don't send it to me tomorrow afternoon and be like, hey, can you throw it in, because I probably can't. So go ahead and do that right now. And also, if you have a special that you'd like to sing, we want to put together some music as well. So if you have a track or if you have a piano or something, sing a song, record it, send it to us. We're going to put together some music for Sunday as well. We will have Easter Sunday here at 10 a.m. on Sunday morning. And I should be back with you tomorrow morning for a 10 a.m. devotional as well. Love you guys. I miss you guys. It's Friday, but Sunday, take care.